Happy to be with you because this is a Sanskrit community, and I know that I am speaking on the dais of the Department of Sanskrit of University of Kerala. Actually, the Department of Sanskrit, University of Kerala, has got a very glorious history. In fact, I think it is the mother of all the departments of Sanskrit in Kerala. It had a very distinguished history. Great people like Professor A. G. Krishna Variar, Professor Vengada Subramaniyar, and so many other people have adorned Professor Unni, like that Professor Unnithiri. A lot of people have been associated with this department, and the publication from publications from Trivandrum are world renowned. Even now, people are in search of the manuscripts deposited in the manuscript library, as well as the wonderful publications which had been brought out by stalwarts belonging to this university. I understand that you are having a seminar on modern writings. Actually, I am not that much involved in the study of modern literature. Because in once, not because it is not interesting, but because of my preoccupation with some other areas of Sanskrit. But by fate, I had the occasion to be associated with modern writings in Sanskrit in some capacity. So for a long time, I was a member of the advisory board for Sanskrit in Sahitya Academy, the National School of Literature, New Delhi. So at that time, I had an opportunity to be acquainted with a lot of people who are doing, writing in Sanskrit, who are engaged in creative writing in Sanskrit, like poets, short story writers, even ghazal writers are there, haiku writers are there. So many people are interested in a lot of new avenues, and these Sanskrit authors have created an idiom for contemporary writing. That their Sanskrit is somewhat different from what we get in classical Sanskrit. Among such works, it was my great fortune that I came across Sri Ramakirti Mahakavyam of Professor Satyavrata Shastri, who is a doyen of Sanskrit learning in modern India. He is internationally acclaimed and a very great scholar, and it was also my fortune to be associated with him as a member in the panel of the advisory board of Sanskrit. At that time, Professor had completed his work, and this work got the Jnanapeeda Award, Ramakirti Mahakavi. And it is a matter of great pride for me that he asked me to write a translation for the work in Malayalam. That is how I got engaged in the study of Ramakirti Mahakavya. So today I will be talking about this particular work. This is the translation I have done. Our professor Prajit has mentioned this one. This is the translation which I had done for Sahitya Academy, and this is the original work. This with the Kannada translation and English translation, that is the work which fetched him the very prestigious Jnanapeeda Award. So only one person has been so far selected for Jnanapeeda Award. So you know the caliber of the author, the greatness of the work. This is the work which we are going to discuss today, the Ramakirti Mahakavya of Professor Satyavrata Shastri. This is a small photo which I have shown, I have told you the original work. Now, and the features, why this work is outstanding. Of course, it is the Jnanapeeda Award winning work in Sanskrit. Just imagine a work like this Ramakirti Mahakavya competing with works which are written in all the other Indian languages like Malayalam or Hindi or Bengali, Assami, Tamil, etc., etc. These are all modern languages, and there is a lot of creative output in these languages. It's a very tough job to even to reach the final list. But Professor Satyavarada Shastri's work made it, and if he was honored with the Jnanapeeda Award. So it is a Sanskrit Mahakavya, which has 25 sargas written in very chaste Sanskrit. Then the most salient feature of Ramakirti Mahakavya is that it deals with the Ramayana story. You know, you have heard about Professor A.K. Ramanujan, who has written a work called 300 Ramayanas. Many people wrongly imagine that there is only one Ramayana, one drama story. No, that is not true. There are hundreds of Mahabharata in India and outside India. That also is very, very important. In India, you have what Sanskrit Ramayanas, Adhyatma Ramayana, Valmiki Ramayana is the mother of all these Ramayanas, then Jataka Ramayana is the. Then you have got a lot of adaptations in all the regional languages. You know Kamba Ramayana, you know our own Adhyalpa Ramayana, you know the Ramacharita. These are all great works written by great regional authors in all the languages. Kritya Ramayana, Albuda Ramayana, etc. etc. But it is something very interesting that far away in Thailand, Ramayana is very prevalent. Ramayana is prevalent in all the South Asian, Southeast Asian countries, actually. I had the great privilege of visiting almost all these places like Thailand, Cambodia, Malaysia, Singapore, and many other regions. So, everywhere you will find that Ramayana is very popular. Even now, there are Indonesia, for example, in Bali, Indonesia is very famous for the Ramayana Mela, which is even now being performed in Thailand also. And the Ramayana story, which is prevalent in Thailand, is called Ramkeem. Ramkeem. What do we mean by Ramkeem? Ram is, of course, Rama. Keem is Kirti. So, Rama Kirti, the fame of Rama. That is the meaning. Rama story, Rama's fame, etc. And Professor Satyavrata Shastri had been the visiting professor of Sanskrit in Thailand, in Chilpakon University, where he taught Sanskrit, and he also taught Sanskrit to the royal descendants, to the princess of Thailand. Thailand, you know, even now has got this royalty, kingship. The king is the supreme head, king or the queen. And he had the great opportunity to teach them. They all love the Sanskrit language. A lot of words, you will be very much interested to note that there are a lot of Sanskrit words in Thailand, as well as in other countries like Malaysia. Malaysia, Bhumiputra is a word which is used for people belonging to that place. And in Thailand also, the airport, what is the name of the airport? Do you know? Have you got any idea? It is called Swarnabhumi. It is called Swarnabhumi. And there is a huge statue, a sculpture depicting the churning of the milky ocean, our Kshirabdi Mathana. Palai Madara. That is depicted in the airport. I have never seen such a thing in Indian airports, but in Suvarnabhumi airport, you know what? That shows how people are so close to Indian tradition. So, Professor Satyavrata Shastri went there, and he was so much interested to learn that the people, they had a rich Rama, that is, Ramayana tradition. And so what he did is that there are some Ramayanas, Ramkeen works in the Thai language, and he studied them, and on the basis of that he wanted to write a Mahakavya in Sanskrit. So it is like Ramayana coming back to its own original language. So it has my, it, just imagine what happened to Ramayana story. You see, somehow in early medieval period, Ramayana, Mahabharata, and other aspects of Indian culture had migrated to many parts of the world, including the Southeast Asian countries. And it was cultivated there. People were so much interested that they adapted it as a regional art form. And even now, there is a place called Ayutthaya, Ayutthaya in Thailand. What is Ayutthaya? It is only Ayodhya. And there is a beautiful island called Langkawi in Malaysia that is made, that is named after our own, this Sri Lanka. So this is that tradition continues even now. People trace their ancestry to Rama's lineage. One thing about Thailand is that they will not allow you to take back Ramayana to your country, that is India. They will not allow you to believe that Rama belonged to India. Originally, Rama belonged to India. Ramayana belonged to India. They believe that Ramayana was written in their country, in Thailand. They believe that Rama belonged to their country, their place. And there are many, many place names in Thailand which commemorate its association with Rama. So their belief is that Rama, Sita, Lakshmana, all these people, even Ravana, belonged to their region, their country. So Satyavrata Shastri wrote this Mahakavya to describe the Rama story in chaste Sanskrit. And so it is the first Mahakavya in Sanskrit on any Ramayana which is prevalent in Southeast Asia. Now, Professor Satyavrata Shastri, already you know something about him. I am told that he had inaugurated your webinar, and he is, by the grace of God, he is still very healthy and hale and healthy. And we can say that he is the Doyen of Sanskrit in modern India. And I give you a very brief outline of his life history. He was born on 29th September 1930. So now he is 91 years old. And his father was Charudatta Shastri, and he studied under his tutelage. He wanted to make the son a grammarian, and he would recite Panini's Ashtachayi when this little boy was in the womb of his mother. So, but he is a great scholar in grammar, but he became a poet. He has used Sanskrit for any purpose. For example, he started writing letters in Sanskrit, and they have been published. He has written his autobiography in Sanskrit. He has written hundreds of articles in Sanskrit, many creative works in Sanskrit. And he is a good poet also, and he was very illustrious. He has an academic career. He was vice chancellor in a couple of universities. He served at Delhi University for a very long time, and many foreign universities, including the Shilpa Kon University, which I have mentioned just now. And he has the author of more than 100 research papers also. Then I will give you a gist of the background of Ramakirti Mahakavya. How he started writing this work. While he was in Bangkok, he learned about the great interest of the ruling dynasty in Sanskrit and in Ramayana especially. And he studied this Ramakirti, and he started writing the Mahakavya. You know the story of the genesis of original Ramayana. Kalidasa has said, Dishada vithanda jadasanotha shlokatva mahavadyada yasya shlokaha. And that has been very beautifully brought out by Anandavardhana also in his Dunya Loga. Kavya Selpasaya Vartastatha Chadigave Pura Kraunjadundu Yoga Shloka Shlokatvam Agata. Shloka Shlokatvam Agata. So that is the genesis of Ramayana. It is like, as Wordsworth has put it, it is like the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. So when, because Valmiki was inspired, he did not write using deliberately thinking this or that. It was a very wonderful, mellifluous flow of words. He started writing automatically. So the same was the experience of Professor Satyavrata Shastri. So he says how he started writing Ramakirti Mahakavya. He says, you see, hear what he has to say. Words after words started pouring in. The verses were flowing through my pen. It was just a labor of love. Nobody asked him to write, but he volunteered. He started writing. Nobody asking me to do it. No prompting, except from within. It was a great joy creating something in Sanskrit, the language of gods, the Devabhasha, almost bordering on bliss, heavenly ananda. That was what he was experiencing. I have drunken from the cup of this joy to the brim the period I have been working at the Kavya. So he worked for the Kavya for some time. At that time, he was enjoying, he was drinking bliss or ananda. It had all been spontaneous. I did not prepare any fair. So another thing is that when we people write something like a PhD thesis, we will be having a rough draft. Then we will improve. We will again correct. We will go on correcting. And finally, we reach the final version. But in the case of Professor Shastri, it was not like that. He did not prepare any fair copy of the work from the draft. And he gave the draft to the typist. At that time, there was no computer, remember? And the typist was typing these things. So he will give his draft to the typist without any correction. He will give it to the typist. And without any correction, it will be typewritten. And it was published. This shows how the stanzas have come out of me, well-formed, in a variety of meters and rhythms. And further, he says, it seems some unseen power was behind this. So he felt that there was some sort of a divine power, Shakti, which was infused in him by virtue of it. He was able to write this. Then, I will just read out a few lines to give you a taste of Ramakirti Mahakavya and to give further illuminate about the nature of the work. So, the first sarga is like this. Asti Asia Namani Suprasiddhe Dive Vishaledi Vishalakirti Agneya Dingmandala Maulibhudo Desho Adhiramyo Bhuvi Thailandaha. So he says that there is a beautiful island called Thailand in the continent of Asia, which appears like the crown of the south east direction. Chyamedi namadi puranamasya khyatam puranadishu yadvihaya thayidi jatya atyushitasya hedo yam thailandam kathayanti lokaha. So this land was known as Chyama in Puranas, but the people of Thailand, they started calling their own motherland as Thai. They called themselves as Thai, and the land was called Thailand. We in Malayalam pronounce it as Thailand, but actually in English the spelling is TH. In Hindi also they, and Sanskrit also, Professor Satyavrata Shastri uses the word Thai, Tatha, Ratha, Datha of Ratha, Thailand. Raja Prajaranjana Madhathana Sarvatmana Buddhavacha Pramanaha Adulya Teja Padavim Dadana Prashastiyam Bhumi Balabhidanaha. So this is being ruled by a king called Bhumibala. You know the Sanskrit word is Sanskrit for the name of the king. And he is engaged in entertaining his subjects, and he obeys the rules of Thailand. Is a Buddhist country, and Buddha, Lord Buddha, is revered with great respect. And you may be wondering, then how can it cultivate Rama, etc., etc. So you can see that there is perfect harmony between Hinduism and Buddhism in Thailand and all the other countries like Cambodia, because people respect both these religions. People go to the temples. People also go to the viharas. There is absolutely no quarrel between them. Agrishta pachyam khalu yatra sasyam yamyastatha shadula bhuvibhaga mandam pravandascha yadidhyavada agantukanam ramayandi kera. So
He says that the land is agrishta pachyam. No cultivation is necessary. Naturally, everything is grown. It is a very fertile place, and there are very meadows filled with green grass, and there is a gentle wind blowing through, which gives pleasure to the people. Teshasya tasyasti brisham vishala kandhe bhuvashukrat shubhratarevamala aishwarya saundarya vilasadhani bainkankanami khalu rajadhani. So he speaks about Bangkok, which is the capital city. It is a very beautiful place. It is prosperous, and it is like a white necklace worn by Mother Earth. Bangkok edi samakhyasyaha yadyapi pratithapurah tathapi sthayi deshiya neenayedam prajakshate. So even though it is called Bangkok, people they call it they don't call it Bangkok. They say Krungthe Veti Anyadevasti Namateshu Prathangadam Prayunjade Tadevede Na Bangkok Idi Jati. So they use the word Krungthe and not Bangkok. Krung Shabda Sthayi Mulosti Theva Samskrita Mulakaha Krung Shabdartha Sthanamidi Thevo Devarthako Matha. Actually, this Krungthev is Krung plus Thev. Krung is a Thai word and Thev is a Sanskrit word. Thev means a Deva and Krung means Krung means a place. Deva means gods. So it is the abode of gods. That is the meaning of Krungthev. Okay. Devasthanam Avedartha. So, and Adida Kinjita Tika Hairanam Shatadui Prasyasya Nivishtasya Sudaram Rutisharinaha. So, originally I have already told you there was a place called Ayutthaya, which was the capital city, but it was destroyed by the Burmese army. Then, after some time, Thailand became the capital city, and it has got a history of only 200 years. Chakrivamshya Bhumipalaha Thai Desham Prashasati Tanmula Purusha Kaschit Puramedan Nivesis. So these people, this dynasty is called Chakri Vamsha, and one gentleman, he established this capital city. Then Ramakirtiri Tikhyadam. So Buddha Yodhedi Namasir Tasya Vidyun Mahamanahe. So that king who established this city was called Buddhayotfa. His name, and he wrote a kavya in his own Thai language, Ramagatham Sovajayo Jago Kavi Durandara. Ramakirtiri Dikhyatam Tat Kavyam Adivistritam Nana Sahasra Sankhyagehi Nibaddham Hrudayangamehi. Padyarubesha Ramagatham Avandara Kathachadehi Joshel Sudaram Ruchehi Adhilogam Virajate. So it has got a lot of stories, hundreds of episodes, and that story is very much popular in this Thai land. Nadrishtam va Shrutam va Vikavyam Tadrik Manoharam Ramagatha Ganaparam Ityatratya Prajakshate. So people belonging to Thailand believe that there is no such a work other than this Ramakirti, which is as beautiful as Ramakirti. And there is a beautiful verse by Professor Satyavrata Shastri. Padham padham chatat kavyam, payam payam chatat drasam, kavyamrudarasa jnanam, naiva tripti prajayate. People are not at all, they never attain satisfaction. Even though they read again and again that poem, and even though they enjoy, they drink again and again, it's rasa. So the ideal sahrudayas, kavyamrita rasatnyana naiva tripti prajayate. So buddha nail arth letya akhya satvaro nirbadir varaha prastoshit natya rupena ramagatha manohara. So there was a gentleman called Budhanai Lartila, and he was also a king, and he prepared a performance text for this Ramakirti. അശിശ്രീയൽസ സംക്ഷേപം രാമഗാഥാനിരൂപണേ അതോ നാട്യപ്രയോഗാർത്ഥം ഉപയോക്താസ്തി തത്കൃതി. സോ ദിസ് ഈസ് രാമകൃതി ഈസ് എ വെരി ബിഗ് എപ്പിക്. ബട്ട് സോ വെൻ യു വാണ്ട് ടു പെർഫോം ഇറ്റ് യു ഹാവ് ടു എഡിറ്റ് ഇറ്റ്. സോ ദിസ് ബുധനായി ലർട്ട്ലി ഹി അബ്രിഡ്ജ് ദാറ്റ് ഫോർ ദ സ്റ്റേജ് ആൻഡ് നൗ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ബീയിങ് യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ ദ സ്റ്റേജ് ഈവൻ നൗ. തദ്വർണിതാം രാമഗാഥാം കൗശലേന പ്രയുഞ്ജതേ തദുച്ചാരണയോഗേന സമ്പ്രത്യപി കുശീലവാഹ. സോ ഈവൻ നൗ കുശീലവാസ് യു നോ ദീസ് ആക്ടേഴ്സ് ആൻഡ് മ്യൂസീഷ്യൻസ് ഈവൻ നൗ ദേ സ്റ്റേജ് ഐ വിൽ ഷോ യു പിക്ചർ ഓഫ് ദിസ് രാമ ദിസ് രാമ സ്റ്റോറി ബീയിങ് എനാക്ടഡ് ദെൻ ഹൗ ഡു ദേ പെർഫോം വസാനാഹ അഠേവർണാനി വാസാംസി രുചിരാണി തേ ഛത്മുഖാവൃത മുഖാഹ രഞ്ജയന്തി നിർണാമന. സോ ദേ wear mask. Now all of us are using masks for COVID, but this is a different type of mask as we use in Krishnanatam and many folk forms. And they, you know, dress themselves up in very colorful garments and they perform. They attract people because of that. Abhineyam tatha vastu kushalaha prastuvandite yena gudhopi tadbhava spudobhavi tarchana. And they enact it in such a beautiful way that even the people who cannot grasp the meaning will be able to understand by looking at the eyes of the actors, because the eyes themselves convey the meaning. Yes. So this is how now I will say something about their belief system. ധായി ദേശാസ്തപൂർവം നൈവാജാനൻ മനാഗപി രാമായണസ്യ കർത്താസീത് വാൽമീകിർ മുനി പുംഗവ. സോ ദർ വാസ് അനദർ കിങ് കാൾഡ് മങ്കുട ആൻഡ് ഹി ആൾസോ ക്രിയേറ്റഡ് രാമഗാഥ ആൻഡ് ഇൻ ദാറ്റ് വർക്ക് ഹീസ് മെൻഷൻസ് വാൽമീകി ആൻഡ് ബിഫോർ ഹിം പീപ്പിൾ ഡിഡ് നോട്ട് എവർ ഇമാജിൻ ദാറ്റ് ദർ ഈസ് എ ജെന്റിൽമാൻ കാൾഡ് വാൽമീകി, എ ഗ്രേറ്റ് പോയറ്റ് കാൾഡ് വാൽമീകി. He had written an original Ramayana, Valmiki Ramayana, that is very famous in India. These things are not known to Thai people. Even now, many people do not know that. So when you say that we have Valmiki Ramayana, they will be asking, oh, you also have got a Ramayana. If you go to Indonesia and you say that, you say something about Mahabharata, the Indonesian people will tell you, oh, you also have got a Mahabharata. We have got a great Mahabharata. Probably the Mahabharata which is in India is taken from us. That is how they believe. So, Thai Deshya Ramagada Abhudatrasya Samibhava Nirbhadir Mangura Purvam Ityevam Menire Jana. So, before Mangura, people believed that it belonged to this Ramagada originated in Thailand. And even now, people believe that Rama belonged to that region. And There are two old inscriptions depicting scenes from Ramayana in the northeast of Bangkok. And there are two performing arts, Korn, which is a masked drama, and Rabam. Both of them enact Ramayana. Then stage, page, image, wall carving, painting. You see representation on the stage act. Then page, books are written about Ramayana. Then image, there are pictures about Rama story. Wall carving, then painting. So everywhere you find Ramayana. If you go to Southeast Asian countries, you will be surprised to find that all these great heroes of ancient Indian epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata are even now greatly respected. Recently, I had been to Thailand, and again once I was in Indonesia, that Bali, island of Bali. In Bali, you can see in all the traffic islands, there will be huge statues depicting scenes from Mahabharata, especially the Gita Upadesha. Then Arjuna will be there. Sometimes it will be Ramayana. Hanuman is very, very popular there. Hanuman and his huge statue will be there. Maybe you will never find these things in any traffic island in India, but in Thailand or in Bali, the island of Bali, or many other parts of South Asia, you find the Southeast Asia, you find this one. Now I will just show you a picture of this Ramayana being enacted. See, Rama is sitting on a chariot, and the chariot is drawn by Lakshmana. Now, of course, they are wearing something like cooling glass, but these are all because of modern innovations. There is a beautiful umbrella which you find in Trichur, Pur, and Samudra, very similar to that, isn't it? And there is a royal. There are people accompanying him in that chariot, and that chariot is drawn as a part of this enactment of Ramayana story. So you can see how a beautiful story from India migrated to that region. Now, I will say something about Ram King. We don't have much of time. It's a huge work, but I will try to limit myself to the time allotted to me and give you the story in a very brief manner. Ram King, they believe that all the characters, Rama and all the people, they belong to Thailand. Then Hanuman was the son of Anjana and Shiva, not Vayu, Shiva. Then another thing is that Lakshmana kills the son of Shurpanaka. The enmity between Lakshmana and Shurpanaka is that Lakshmana killed the son of Shurpanaka. Then Ravana, disguised as an ascetic, pleads Rama to give a fight before the construction of the dam. So that is another innovation. Then there is a lady called Benjakaya, very important lady. She is the daughter of Vibhishana. Have you ever heard about the daughter of Vibhishana? No, in Thai Ramayana there is there. And she, I will describe these things later. And Hanuman is a very different character. He makes love to a lot of ladies. In our Indian tradition, he is a Puritan. He is an ascetic, and he always thinks about only one person, that is Rama. But in if you go to Southeast Asia, if you go to Bali Island, if you go to Thailand, if you go to Cambodia, if you go to Laos, if you go to Vietnam, there, you know, Hanuman is a totally different person. He is a very mischievous character. Of course, he is a follower, ardent follower of Rama, but he makes love to many ladies. You are going to see presently. Now, I will just analyze the Ramayana, Thai Ramayana, Ramakirti Mahavya. It has got, then the first canto, the author describes Thailand and Bangkok. We have seen that. Its capital city and traces the history of Ram King in the country. In the second chapter, we have the birth of Anomathan, the first king after the Thai Ramayana. The narration of Rama story. So you see, after Thai Ramayana, because the Thai people believed that Dasharatha, Rama, all these people belong to Thailand, and the Rama's lineage came to an end. Then another Rajavamsa comes, and that first king is called Anomathan. The narration of Rama story begins with the havoc caused by Hiranyaksha. There is a god, the Hiranyaksha is there. God's approach, Ishvara. There is a character called Ishvara who bids Narayana to kill the demon. So Ishvara commands Narayana. Ishvara is probably Brahma who commands Narayana to kill the demon. He sees a child lying in a lotus and presents it to Ishvara. Ishvara names him Anomathan and asks him to build Ayodhya. Then this Anomathan builds the city of Ayutthaya or Ayodhya. Dasharatha is born to Rama, he is born to Anomathan, and Rama is born to Dasharatha. And in the next cantos, we say Dasharatha performs the Putreshti, which is called Putreshti, Putragameshti, for progeny with the help of sage Klaikodi. That is a totally different person, not sage Vasishta. The sage seeks the help of Ishvara to get Narayana born as Dasharatha's son. Narayana agrees, but there is one condition, that he will be born with his shankha, conch shell, diska chakra, and mace gada, and Lakshmi also will come to the earth along with him. Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, all of them are born from the four rice balls are there. So what happens is that this is not payasam, it is four rice balls, and two of them are stolen by a bird, and there are only two, and out of these two, half is taken by first lady, then another half is taken by the Kaikeyi, and there are these two halves left, and that is fed to Sumitra, and she gets two children. The same story. Then what happened? story of, then there is Nandalaka, Nandala, Nandaka, not Nandaka, Nandalaka, the servant of Ishara. Yes, Nandaka, that is the servant of Ishara, who is insulted by gods. And he is actually an attendant of Shiva. And he had a romance with a lady. He just made some remarks to a lady attendant of Shiva. And then these people, gods, became very much angry. And then what happened? He undertook penance. He undertook penance, and he, like our Bhasmasura, and he got a boon that if he points his finger to anybody, that person will be destroyed. Then Narayana comes in the form of a nymph, as in Indian tradition, an apsaras, and they dance together, and Narayana points his own finger on himself. And this demon points his own finger on himself, and he is destroyed by that. Then Narayana grants him a boon that he will be born, reborn as Ravana. So originally Nandaka, the servant of Ishvara, that person is born as Ravana. Then Narayana takes birth as Rama, and this Nandaka takes birth as Ravana. Then Mandodari was already there, and she took a ball stolen by Kankana, and she gets a child, and this child is abandoned by Ravana, and she is born as Sita. So in this story, Sita is the daughter of Mandodari. Then Rama marries her and defeats Parashurama. Here is Ramasura, who obstructs his path. Then what happened in the fifth canto? Rama has to go to the forest with the command of Dasaratha, because of the insinuation of Kaikeyi. Then Ravana accidentally kills Jihva, Shurpanaka's husband. Jihva Shurpanaka's husband, Ravana's brother-in-law. And Ravana had asked him to protect Lanka. Ravana had gone out. Then what happened? This Jihva was very much feeling sleepy. So he didn't want to leave the country for unprotected. So he encircled the island of Sri Lanka with his tongue. Then what happened? Ravana came there and found that he is asleep, and found that his Sri Lanka is encircled by a huge tongue. He cut the tongue, and so Jihva was killed. And then Shurpanaka goes to the forest in search of a new husband, because her husband is already gone, and he is assaulted by Lakshmana. So she goes to Lakshmana and Rama. Then she is attacked by Lakshmana, and she poisons the mind of Ravana. Then Ravana sends Marija, again in the same story, and Marija comes in the form of a golden deer, and Ravana abducts Sita, disguised as an ascetic, and Jadayu, the bird, comes. All the same stories there. Then there is another person, Nandalaka. He is a god of Shiva. He makes amorous advancement to an attendant, and he is cursed by Shiva to become a buffalo. And he is born as Darabhi. He kills all the Darabhi, gets a lot of buffalo children. And when they are born, he kills them. The same moment, without any hesitation. Then his wife becomes very angry, and she goes away, and she gives birth to a child. And that child kills his father and attacks Ishvara. Then Ishvara asks him to try his valor on Balin Sugriva. And Balin kills him. And Balin asks Sugriva to guard the cave. And Balin tells him that if blood comes, that shows that, the same story as in Ramayana. And what happens is that poor Lakshmana, Sugriva is deceived by this demon, and he wrongly thinks that Balin is killed, and he seals that cave. And Balin wrongly thinks that Sugriva tried to kill him, and there is a great enmity between them. Then Ravana then what happens? Then Rama is in search of Sita. He then so he meets Sugriva. Sugriva seeks his help, and Rama kills Balin. Then what happens? Ravana, then Vibhishana is very unhappy with Ravana for having stolen the wife of somebody else and asks him to return this to Rama. But Ravana becomes angry and he throws away Vibhishana. And then what happens? Vibhishana goes to Rama's camp, and there are a lot of spies there. A spy called Shukrasara comes as a hawk, Parindira, and then as a monkey, he goes to the place of Rama. Then Vibhishana understands that he is a Ravana spy and identifies him, and his whole body is tattooed and he is killed. And Ravana himself comes as disguised as a mendicant, and ascetic, and asks Rama, don't quarrel with Ravana, he will kill you. But that doesn't take place. Then what happens? There is a girl called Benjakaya. Benjakaya is the daughter of Vibhishana, and she, Ravana tells her to deceive Rama. So she pretends that she is a dead body, and she floats in a river near Rama. She takes the guise of Sita. So Rama thinks that Sita is dead. But then Hanuman, what happens? Hanuman is not at all convinced by this. He takes this so-called dead body, puts it on a pyre, and lights up that pyre. Then what happens? She feels the heat and she goes up to the sky. Then Hanuman takes hold of her. He comes back with her. Then what happens? Hanuman falls in love with Benjakaya, who is actually the daughter of Vibhishana. Vibhishana asked Rama to kill her, but Rama does not want to kill her. Benjakaya and Hanuman fall in love with each other, and a child is born to them. He is called Asurafat. Asurafat. Then there are two. Then Rama and wants to go to Sri Lanka. Then Hanuman had located that Sita is there. They want to build a dam there. Then there are two monkeys who are interested. One is called Neela and the other is Hanuman. Both of them are quarreling with each other. So whatever Hanuman does, Neela delays. Then Rama finds it out and Rama punishes Neela. Then immediately, when the obstruction is removed, Hanuman is able to finish the causeway. Then what happens? Every day, Hanuman brings a lot of stones. Next day, no stone is seen, because there is a Malsya Kanyaga called Suvarna Malsya. She takes every stone and goes down to the Patala, to the netherworld. This is found out by Hanuman. Then Hanuman tells her, no, why do you do that? Then she says, I am Ravana's daughter. I have to obey my father. Then Hanuman tells her, why should you obey your father? Your father has done a very wicked thing. He has stolen the wife of somebody. So, and Rama is trying to get back his wife. So don't be a party to this evil. Then she's a very good, nice lady, only because her father had told that. So Suvarna Malsya again falls in love with Hanuman. And a child is born. He is called Machanu. So wherever Hanuman encounters a lady, he falls in love with her, and a child is born to them. Okay. Then there is the story of Mayaraba. Mayaraba is Ravana's friend. You may be amused to learn these words, which are in the Thai language, Mayaraba. Mayaraba. And he is Ravana's friend. And Ravana, he wants to help Ravana. He puts Rama's army to sleep with a special sleeping powder, sleeping pills. And then he takes Rama to Patala. Then Hanuman, next morning, nobody finds Rama anywhere. And Hanuman goes down to Patala. And he enters into the stalk of a lotus and goes down and reaches Patala. Then he finds another lake where that is guarded by Machanu. He is guarding Rama. He is under the command of Ravana. Then they fight with each other, as in our this Madhyamaya Yoga. Their father and the son fight. But ultimately, Hanuman wins. And Hanuman understands that he is his own son. and he, with the help of his son, he reaches Padala, and he is obstructed by all things, you know. First of all, by a mountain, then by an elephant, and lastly by mosquitoes. But Hanuman is not at all daunted by this. He removes all these obstacles, and he transforms himself into a lotus stalk, and he reaches Rama. He rescues Rama. Then there is a very pious king called Malivagga Brahma. Malivagga Brahma is a very pious, and Ravana seeks his help. Ravana says that Rama is attacking him. So, oh king, please help me. Then Malivagga Brahma says that, Ravana, I will first of all ascertain whether you are speaking the truth. I want to hear from Rama and Sita what has happened. And Rama and Sita are brought to his presence, and they tell him that Ravana had abducted Sita. And this Malivagga Brahma is a very virtuous person. He becomes very much angry with Ravana and curses him. Then what happens? There is a fight going on, and Vibhishana tells Rama that it is not easy to kill Ravana, because Ravana's soul, Atman, is kept in a cage in a place called Goputra, in a, under the custody of sage Goputra, in a hermitage of sage Goputra. So Hanuman readily agrees. So he says that I will get hold of the soul. So he goes Angada, with Angada he goes to Goputra and tells him that he has. Then Hanuman is very intelligent. He says that I am coming from Rama. I am not happy with Rama. He is now my enemy. So please give me refuge, and I want to go to Ravana's place. So please come with me. Then Goputra, sage Goputra, believes that what he says is true, and then both of them go to the other with Angada. Then at that time Hanuman says, you have got a cage with you. That is in the cage there is Ravana's soul. So you take that cage with you, because somebody else will steal that. Rama's agents will come and steal that. So you take it with you. Then this stupid Goputra believes what Ravana, Hanuman says is true. And then what happens, both of them go, they go there. Then when they reach Sri Lanka, Hanuman tells him, see, you cannot take the cage with you. So you do one thing. You give the cage to Angada. Both of us will go to Ravana. And this stupid Goputra believes what Hanuman says. And Angada, he gives hands over the cage to Angada. Immediately, Angada kills Ravana's Ravana. The soul of Ravana is destroyed. Then Rama is able to kill Ravana. Then Vainasura Vamsha. Then what happened? Ravana is killed. Then Ravana has got a child born of Mandodari. He is called Vainasura Vamsha. And he becomes so much angry with Vibhishana. He wants to kill Vibhishana. Asurafadha is the son of Hanuman and Banjagai. He is there. He finds out Hanuman. And Hanuman, along with Bharata and Shatrughna, marches to Lanka and kills Vainasura Vamsha. That also is a part. Then what happens there? Very, very interesting. You know, this is very different from the Ramayana which we have got. Then what happens? Sita comes back. They live happily together. Then at that time, there is a girl called Adhura. She is the daughter of Shurpanaka. She wants to wreak vengeance on Sita because Ravana is being killed. So this Adhula asks Sita to draw the picture of Ravana. She says that we have never seen Ravana. So please tell us how is Ravana. Sita says, I will not draw the picture of Ravana. Then again and again she asks him. She Adhula is an attendant. She is disguised as an attendant. And then poor Sita draws the picture of Rama. Then suddenly Rama comes there. Then she hides that picture under their bed. Then Rama lies there for sleep. Then she feels there is a heat. Then Rama asks Lakshmana, what is that? Then Lakshmana searches everywhere and finds out their picture drawn by Sita. And Sita asks Sita. Then Sita says that Jesus, I had drawn. But Rama is very much angry with her. And Rama asks Lakshmana to take her to the forest, to kill her, and to take her heart back. That is that happened. Then Lakshmana goes there. Then Sita reaches the
hermitage of Vajmruga, and because in the forest, that is Sita, then Lakshmana takes her to the forest, and Lakshmana wants to kill her. He doesn't actually want to kill her, but the command of his, he has to obey the command of his brother. So he takes a sword and hits at Sita. Then what happens is that touches the chastity of Sita, that anybody who is hitting her will fall down unconscious. And twice Lakshmana falls unconscious, and Lakshmana goes back and tells Rama that I have killed Sita. And Rama had asked the heart of Sita, and Lakshmana on the way had found the heart of a deer, a mruga, and he says that this is the heart of Sita. And then Sita, what happens? There, Indra comes. Indra is disguised as a buffalo, and he wants to help Sita, and he Sita follows him, and Sita reaches the hermitage of sage Vajmruga, not Valmiki, Vajmruga. And Sita gives birth only to Lava. Kusha is not, there is no Kusha in the story. And she is nursed by Indrayani. Then what happens? Sita has got only one child, and the sage Vajmruga has drawn the picture of a boy, and he gives life to him so that Sita's child can play with him. That child is called Manguda, not Kusha. Manguda, so Lava and Manguda, they become friends. And then what happens? Rama wants to, Rama performs an Ashwamedha, and the horse is sent there. And both Lava and Manguda are angry at Rama's pride, and they capture that horse. And there is a fight going on between Rama and these children. And Rama ultimately recognizes that these children, Lava is his own son. And then what happens? Then he asks Sita to come back. Sita is so much angry with Rama that I will never come with you. You are such a deceitful person. Then what happens? Rama sends somebody. And they say that Rama is dead. If you want to see the body of Sita, Rama, you can come with us. Then Sita becomes so much miserable hearing this. And she goes to Ayodhya. There she finds that Rama is healthy. And then Rama says, I just wanted to get you back. Then Sita says that I will never come with you. You are such a deceitful person. You have spoiled my life. You tried to kill me, and now you want to cheat me. I don't want to live the rest of my life with a cheat like this. Then what happens? The gods decide that Lord Shiva convenes an assemblage of gods, and at that time he asks Sita. He says that Rama has not been very good, I know, but you do want, forgive him, and you please. He is a good king, and he is such a miserable person now, and he cannot rule the country properly. But so it is your duty, so you go with him. And finally, Sita agrees to be with Rama. So this is the story of Ramakirti Mahakavya, and a very beautiful story. And Professor Satyavrata Shastri has made use of his thorough knowledge of Sanskrit literature, his acquaint Kavya Parichaya, and he has made use of excellent figures of speech and all the beautiful meters of Sanskrit to write such a Mahakavya. And the story is very gripping, and the narration also is very interesting. There are a lot of interesting characters like Rama, Lakshmana, then Vibhishana is a wonderful character, and Hanuman is a very colorful character. You know, I had once gone to the island of Bali, where they perform Ramayana story as a folk performance. There also you can see the hundreds of people will be there, and they will clap their hands the moment Hanuman comes there. So Hanuman is a very, very famous character So Hanuman is there. Ravana also is there. Mandodari. So all these characters, and some of the characters have undergone a lot of change in Thailand. Some of these changes are because of the change in India itself. Some of these changes were brought about by the people of Thailand. So if you read this work, already the translation has appeared in Malayalam, my translation, you will find that it is very interesting, and it enriches the Ramayana literature all over the world. So I think I will conclude with these few words. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Thank you.